Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 21st meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. The first item on the agenda is a decision on taking business in private. This is a decision on taking items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Item 3 is a consideration of the evidence heard on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. Item 4 is further consideration of visits and engagement as part of our scrutiny of that bill. And item 5 is to consider an approach to a proposal for the UK government's legislating in a devolved area. For the record, and we're not proposing to formally dispose of that notification at a meeting. Sorry, we do propose to formally dispose of that notification in a public at a meeting in the near future. And today is just purely preliminary consideration of how we approach that item. The question is, are we agreed to take these items in private? We are agreed. Our main item is agenda item 2, then, is a first evidence session of the stage 1 on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. And we'll be taking evidence from the Scottish Land Commission. I'm pleased to welcome Mike Russell, the Chair, Emma Cooper, the Head of Land Rights and Responsibility, Bob McIntosh, the Tenant Farming Commissioner, and Hamish Trench, the Chief Executive of Scottish Land Commission. Now, we've allocated quite a lot of time for this, but that doesn't mean we have to have long answers to all the short, hopeful questions. But before we do that, I'd like to make a declaration, and it is a declaration that I'm happy to make, and we'll make at each meeting subsequent to this bill when we're discussing it. For the record, as per my register of interest, I own approximately 500 acres in Moray, and that's 500 acres that I farm in hand. Approximately 50 acres of that is woodland. I am a tenant under a non-agricultural tenancy for a further 500 acres in Moray, and I'm a tenant under a 1991 Secure Tenancy Farming Act. I also, where possible, sometimes take in annual lets for grassland to help feed my cattle. All details of all of that can be found in my register of interest. And I hope that clarifies my position. So we're going to move to the first question. And I think I'm going to get a gentle question on the record to start with. Can you just outline the research that was undertaken, and I'm not sure who this is going to go to, probably to Hamish, that led to the recommendation that further reforms were needed to address the issues of concentrated ownership? Hamish, do you want to just talk about that, or Mike, whoever wants to do it?
Hamish.
Yeah, I'm happy to say a bit about that. So back in 2019, we undertook a sort of 18-month programme of research looking at the issues associated with scale and concentration in land ownership. That research comprised background research looking at the existing evidence research base, drawing out the key lessons from what was already published and available. It included research on the international experience. We looked, for example, at 22 countries and found that 18 of those regularly have mechanisms in place to manage who can own how much land. And it looked at the different types of international experience and the mechanisms used. And then we also held a public call for evidence, which was an open call for anyone. It was a call for evidence that asked about the advantages and disadvantages, the benefits or disadvantages of concentrated land ownership. We asked people very simple questions as to whether they had a view on the benefits and disadvantages, but also whether they had experience to back that up. The call for evidence had a response over 400 responses. It had, I think, a very balanced response sort of profile. There were, for example, about 29% identifying as residents, 23% private landowners, 19% land management professionals. So a good range of different perspectives feeding into that research. And it found very strongly that there are risks around the concentration of power associated with large-scale land ownership. There's by no means an automatic relationship between scale of ownership and public interest, but there is a very significant risk in terms of the power, the concentration of power. And that was our conclusion and our recommendation to government, that reforms are needed to moderate that power that's inherent in the scale of land ownership.
So on that particular point, was the concentration of power ever seen to be a good thing, or was the concentration of power seen to be a bad thing across the whole of Scotland?
The research showed very clearly that any advantages that were identified were associated with economies of scale, but the concentration of power was a disadvantage. So the issues are very clearly around the disadvantages created by the concentration of power. And for example, on local economic opportunities, a big theme that came through on the ability to unlock opportunities for local development businesses. For example, on local housing opportunities and community cohesion and development. So the disadvantages were all associated with the concentration of power and decision-making.
So, sorry, I'm just struggling to understand the concentration of power for big housing developments are you talking about, or small housing developments?
I think potentially across the piece, the issue is about the control of the land supply, essentially. So where you have a very concentrated pattern of ownership, inevitably the decisions about the release of that land is highly concentrated, sits with very few people. So that can be around one or two sites in a remote rural community, or of course it could be about a larger site.
So any concentration of power, so concentration of power in forestry land, Scotland, that's seen as a negative as well, is it?
Well, important to emphasise that the report and the research showed that these issues run across all types of landowner. It's not simply about private ownership by any means. The report found the similar issues around concentration of ownership applied across public, private, NGO ownership. And it is about the risk of that concentration of power and decision-making.
So, I push that a little bit more on that so I understand it. So, I mean, we know that Forestry Land Scotland are big landowners in Scotland. We know that there are various charities that are big landowners in Scotland. We know that Scottish Natural Heritage or Nature Scot, I'm not sure which they're calling themselves today, are big landowners in Scotland. And that was a problem perceived with all those types of owners, not just people, private landowners.
Yes, that's right. And that's why our recommendations are about moderating the power that's inherent in that scale of ownership, regardless of the type of landowner.
Okay. Yes, of course, yeah. Thank
you, Convener. Mr Trench, you spoke about how you'd considered, as part of your research and then providing the government with your direction, that you'd looked at other European countries. I mean, I don't know if you want to say a bit more about that.
Yes, the initial research, as I say, looked at around 22 different countries, and it does find that it's really quite common to have measures in place to manage the ownership of land in terms of who can own land or how much land can be owned. Some of those, for example, are measures that put a limit on foreign national ownership. Some of those are measures that put constrictions on the way land can be used. Some of them require prior approval before you're able to acquire land. Just in the last year, we undertook a more detailed bit of research on the French SAFER system, which is a system of preemption in an agricultural context, again designed to make sure that land can be brought forward, particularly for developing businesses and new entrants. So I think while it's probably important to say that there's no simple system that you could lift and translate to Scotland, we clearly need to design our own based on the Scottish context. But I think what the research does show is that it is really quite common, indeed Scotland, UK is probably quite unusual, in not having some sort of framework to manage the public interest around land ownership.
Thank you.
Could I just emphasise two things? One is all the material that we're talking about is published and is available on our website, and indeed the documentation that you've had is also footnoted, I hope helpfully, so you can actually see where the information comes from. The second point I just want to make is the point you raised, Convener, about different types of owner. I don't think we have differentiated in that regard. I'm a new boy to this, but certainly from my previous experience, I think that there should be and are obligations on the state as a landholder, which sometimes it does not fulfil. And it is very important that we are able to say that and able to draw attention to that, as we have done and will continue to do.
Thank you. I would never suggest that you are a new boy to this game, Mr. Russell. I think you've been pioneering land reform for some time, so I don't think I'll take the new boy bit, but I'm sure you come with views. Jackie, do you want to come in with a question on that area?
In this area or something? Something.
You had a question.
I've got a fair few questions, Convener. If I can just stay with that for a minute, so, and I'd be interested to hear your views on it. Would it be fair to say that private ownership of land, particularly at scale, has historically afforded significant privilege to the folk that own them?
That would be true. And I think, you know, the evidence is that we've been talking about people, you know, power and prosperity, three words that we use extensively. And I think that, you know, the question that we ask is how we can redress the balance in power so that people have a stronger influence, people who live on the land and are involved in it, and lead to greater prosperity. And the prosperity issue is quite a key one, particularly as new and additional sources of income from land are found. I mean, Hamish might want to add to that, particularly in terms of some of the work that we're beginning to do on new issues that are rising and trying to get community profit from them rather than simply individual profit.
Yeah, happy to expand a bit. I mean, I think it is interesting to look at the current context around the emergence of natural capital value in land. You know, our land is becoming increasingly valuable for different and perhaps unexpected ways. That's quite a useful demonstration that, again, the underlying pattern of ownership is hugely important in the way that the benefits of that value are shared and distributed and used. And as Michael says, it's about using that value productively. How do we reinvest that in local communities and local economies? That is partly to do with the land ownership pattern and the land reform measures. It's also partly to do with wider policy on tax and fiscal and other measures, for example.
Okay, thank you. And if I can move my question slightly, I've had a few meetings with some of the tenant farming community who has spoken very highly of the tenant farmer commissioner, I must say. They said that he's been doing a cracking job, but one of their frustrations has been that he's got no power. Everything seems to be done on a voluntary basis, which, to his credit, he's managed to get things done still, but not quite maybe as much as what the community were wanting. So I'm actually after your comments, because there's been incidences where a landlord just won't engage with the commissioner or other landlords, and also certain land agents won't engage with them either. So I'd like to hear views on what you feel about stronger statutory powers. Do you think that would help? What would you like? If I could give you a magic wand.
I know you're going to answer this in some detail. We will be looking at part two slightly later on in the questioning session, where some of these questions may be answered, but happy for you to give an answer to all that you've achieved.
Statutory powers are limited. I produce codes of practice. People are entitled to complain if they think the code of practice has been breached. I can do an investigation, and then all I could do really is name and shame people on the website. Is that enough? Most of the time I would say yes, because my aim in carrying out this role has, I guess, generally been one of facilitator rather than policeman. I've tried to help people sort out their problems without coming down with a big heavy hand. Have there been occasions when I would like to have come down more heavily? You bet there are, with certain recalcitrant individuals, yes, if it had powers to require them to do something or to fine them for something they hadn't done. Occasionally, yes, I would have liked to be able to do that.
So, I don't know if you want to leave this to part two then, but so moving forward, what would you like to would there be anything in the bill that you would like to see that would give you or the next tenant farming commissioner power to be able to do more?
Well, it's interesting to see that the proposed powers for the new land and communities commissioner, I think, include an ability for him to or her to fine people who don't follow the rules. That's one route that could possibly be used. I have to say I've got mixed views about whether that's the right thing to do, but on balance I think it would be good if the Tenant Farm Commissioner, and it'll be the next one, not me because I'm nearly finished, had some additional powers.
Now, I'm going to park that question there because I know somebody wants to push that slightly more on the new appointment.
Well, I was actually just going to ask about the volunteer, you know, engaging voluntary, you know, with the land agents, because
yes, I don't want you to tread on the toes of another committee member. But that, go with that, yeah.
Okay, absolutely. It was just to ask either yourself or Mr. Russell, what could be done, you know, because I think the state agents, or land agents, I should say, are tend to be businesses on top of, you know, way above the folk that are actually dealing with stuff day to day. So they don't, they tend to be companies. So maybe understand, but that's maybe a bit rude, but maybe don't know, or they just, it's just an investment to them rather than a way of life, so don't want to actually engage because they don't have to, because it's voluntary.
Well, the codes of practice apply to landlords, tenants and their agents. Mm-hmm. So any lawyers or land agent acting for a landlord or tenant is caught by the codes of practice and everything that goes with that. So, and I do engage a lot with the land agent community because they're very important in this. So we did one of the statutory duties I had when I started was to review of how land agents behave in a sense. And really that showed that, like every other sector of community, there are some not so good ones in the land agents, but by and large they do a good job, I think, in helping to oil the wheels between landlords and tenants.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Bob, you've got some questions you'd like to ask.
Yeah, good morning to our witnesses. Thank you for supporting with every session this morning. I want to ask about land management plans, but my first question, can I ask whoever answers it, not to talk about compliance or enforcement or monitoring or reporting or the size of holdings, because I will ask questions about all of that. But principally for large holdings that will be required to produce a land management plan, do the provisions within that for those who do it, do they adequately articulate and strengthen community engagement in a meaningful way, including using the land rights responsibility statement? So I'm not sure who's best placed to answer that, but what are the views of witnesses?
Let me, if I could possibly introduce the answer to that. I think both Hamish and Emma can give you practical on the ground experience. But just to make the point that plans of themselves don't do anything. There's a process to go on through. First of all, the plan has to be comprehensive, but comprehensible. There's no point in producing a plan that nobody reads and can't understand. We should not be seeking to increase burdens unnecessarily on landowners and others. And therefore, as this issue develops with the bill, I think we want to simplify the reporting process rather than complicate it, and also make sure that whatever people are reporting on, they are responsible for. The example I would use is that somebody who has a tenant or a number of tenants cannot be held responsible for everything that those tenants do. So we need to be very clear about how that works. But essentially, the other issue is that they have to be read and they have to be made available. And therefore, you know, the Commission is looking about how we do that and how we would make sure that that material was accessible and people could understand it. So we are thinking about the plans and hope to provide some advice about the plans and what they would look like, including their publication, but hopefully also including laying to rest a bit the fears that people would have about those plans. Sorry, Emma, I think is going to say a word or two about them too.
Yeah, so the land management plans, any good business would be thinking about what their purpose is, what their objectives are, and sharing those with others. So the land management plans are the same kind of process that we see in the corporate world, often the community sector as well, and so on, whereby it's setting those basic things out for others to understand and to see where they can engage with those plans. The land management plans bring that transparency, and they also allow people to be held accountable for the plans that they're putting forward, the things that they're planning to do. But the process of preparing them is also really important. And where we see communities engaged in that planning process with landowners, land managers, land agents, we see really good benefits come out of that for both parties.
So, Emma, can I just ask, because I think that's the crux of the question, I know with the time constraints, is what do you believe the requirements will be under this Act about that community engagement? Because if someone has 3,000 hectares, any community directly impacted by that land ownership should have an absolute right to be meaningfully consulted, recognised and steps taken to address whatever their concerns or aspirations are as part of that land management plan. How does this legislation and land management plans, if done properly, how will it achieve that?
So we don't have all the detail in the bill of how this will work and how communities will be engaged, but where we see good practice happening, that involves building a relationship with key organisations and individuals in a community. In the forestry sector, you have an issues log, for example, where you share publicly the issues that have been raised by your core stakeholders and how you're going to be addressing those. So a similar approach could be taken here in terms of community engagement and land management plans. But really what we're looking at is a meaningful relationship being developed between the landowner and the community, which will enable opportunities for collaboration, for mutual benefits to be realised. So where a community can share their aspirations and a landowner manager can share their aspirations, you can see how that can come together in a way which otherwise can't be enabled. Really, it's about that collaboration element of things.
Okay, Emma, I'm sorry for kind of focusing on yourself, but it's just this was the line of questioning I was hoping to pursue. So that land management, any land management plan will have to take cognizance of the land rights responsibility statement. It doesn't have to follow it. My understanding has to have regard for it, and there will still be no statute underpinning on the land rights responsibility statement. It will be a voluntary matter. What's your view on that? And if once you've given your view, if any of the witnesses have got divergent views, then it'd be good to get that on the record as well.
Thanks. So the land management plans at the moment, there's specific criteria set out in the bill, things that will need to be in the land management plan. That could go further, and it could more broadly address the land rights and responsibilities statement principles. Our protocol set out expectations for landowners, land managers and communities around each of those land rights and responsibilities principles. And land managers across Scotland have implemented those. A good practice programme shows that that's perfectly workable. They have checked themselves against it, so we have a self-evaluation process that people can follow. For the most part, that shows up a few actions that those landowners, land managers can take to further align with the land rights and responsibilities statement, but it's certainly feasible. The land management plans at the moment talk about a range of different things that need to be included, thinking about the purpose of the bill, strengthening that by talking about the sustainability of rural communities could enhance what's in there at the moment. And when we think about sustainability of rural communities and how to achieve that, we think about the land rights and responsibility statement as providing that definition. I think Hamish also would like to come in on this.
Just very briefly, I would add, I mean, I think we're clear that we would advise that compliance and delivery of the land rights and responsibility statement should absolutely be a core requirement of the land management plans, either in the bill or the secondary regulations. And I think the other aspect that I would just flag is that this is also important from a reporting. You asked us not to go here, but I will flag it very briefly from a reporting and disclosure perspective. At present, it is quite hard and difficult to monitor progress and delivery of the land rights and responsibility statement. So this does offer, I think, a very effective route to do that.
Hamish, I'll ask you not to go there because I'm definitely going to go there. I just wanted to break up. So the Land Commission initially considered for a land management plan maybe from 1,000 hectares up to 3,000 hectares should be within the scope of it, and beyond 3,000, of course, but the government's opted for 3,000 hectares. Can I just check, convener, can people still hear me? Because my screen has went blank.
No, we can definitely hear you, and I'm wondering if you're going to ask the question I'm going to ask, but crack on,
well,
Bob.
Hopefully not, convener, because this is my line of questioning. 3,000 hectares is 30 million square metres. It's 5,000 football pitches. Shouldn't it be 1,000 hectares? Are there any concerns that government's went too high for this? Some are suggesting as low as 500. The Land Commission thought maybe 1,000. The government's went for 3,000. What's the views of the Land Commission?
Yeah, happy to comment on that. And yes, our initial advice was between 1,000 and 3,000 would be reasonable. We certainly think there is a fair and strong argument for potentially reducing that threshold to bring more into scope and therefore having a wider impact. I would flag, of course, that the trade-off for that is then the resource burden, both for landowners, government, and indeed the Land and Communities Commissioner. I think, for example, if you were to reduce it to 1,000, then the number of holdings in scope would more than double.
I think that is a very important point from us. I mean, there is a strong argument for reducing it. We've acknowledged that argument. Other people are arguing it too. But the figures are quite clear. At 3,000, it's 430 landholdings. At 1,000, it's 1,066 landholdings. And at 500, it is 2,025 landholdings. So in those circumstances, that would increase the work that, you know, we were required to do quite substantially. And therefore, you know, we could not do it within our own resources. Can I just make the point? 95% of registered agricultural holdings are under 500, so it does not bring in the vast bulk of agricultural holdings.
Okay, that's very helpful. But can I also check, there's a balance being struck, of course, Mr. Russell, in relation to this, and I think that's the point you're making, but the bill also doesn't include cumulative holdings, so you could have a landowner with four concerns, 2,000 hectares each, massive operation that will be covered by this bill. Should cumulative holdings be considered, do you think, Mr. Russell?
Yes, that is another way of making sure that this is a comprehensive and comprehensible, the point I made, innovation. And you can do that by ensuring that the contiguous holdings were not treated as they are treated in the bill.
That's helpful. Can I move on to penalties for non-compliance? I think Mr. Russell said at the start, well, it's nice to have a land management plan. Hopefully you've consulted meaningfully and effectively with communities and other relevant interested groups, and you've got a very sensible, practical, sustainable plan for the land and the people and all those that benefit from that land. But if it's not actually implemented in practice, it's kind of irrelevant. My understanding is there's fines of up to £5,000 for not producing a plan, but there's no consequence within the bill for non-compliance. Is that your understanding, Mr. Russell? Does that have to be looked at again?
I'm looking at Hamish here, but it appears to be the case. I think we would be quite clear that cross-compliance has to be an issue in here too. It is, you know, the fines of their own volition, the fines as a standalone issue, that would not probably be sufficient to ensure compliance, and that cross-compliance, which is perfectly possible, would be a useful part of this of the tool.
Can I push on that further, Mr. Russell? Because cross-compliance is not direct compliance, of course. If you have a large company, sometimes family concerns can be very large companies, I would note. And £5,000 meet well. It's cheaper just to pay the £5,000 rather than comply fully, because that's burdensome, quite frankly. Could we look at other? Could we increase the fine threshold? Could we look at penalties based on the turnover of the business?
Any of those things would be possible, but I think that I would want to assume that the vast majority of people engaged in this would want to issue to deliver those plans. Those plans, as Emma has indicated, will be useful to them. The process of growing up plans will be useful to them. However, there are other options available, and cross-compliance is one of them, which means that, you know, funding from the state would be withheld, you know, if the plan was not delivered. So there are other things that you could do, but I would like to think that there would be a broad support for this, and one was talking about very small numbers of people who would not wish to do so.
I hope we don't mind pushing further, Mr. Russell, because I didn't ask about cross-compliance. I understand cross-compliance. I asked about direct compliance and whether for some businesses £5,000 just didn't cut it. Is it the view of the Land Commission that that should be reviewed again?
We haven't taken a position upon that.
Will you take a position on it during the passage of this
bill?
I think we're
listening to what you're saying, Mr. Dorris, and obviously we'll consider it as we offer further advice. But presently we're saying we accept there is a risk of non-compliance. Cross-compliance would be an additional tool that would be in the box,
okay,
or should be
helpful.
In the box.
That's helpful. My final question, Camilla, you'll be relieved to hear, because I know other members need to get in and we move on with the line of questioning, is some concerns have been raised over the reporting process in relation to this, that we should widen the scope of who's able to report and for investigations and monitoring to be more robust in relation to that. I have to admit, I'm not over the detail of this particular area, but I'd be very keen for witnesses to put on the record their thoughts on that to better inform me as we move forward with this legislation.
We do agree that there is a need to expand that list. Emma, you've been involved in this.
Yeah, absolutely. So with our Good Practice programme casework, we hear from a variety of community bodies, different kinds of organisations and stakeholders about concerns they have a lot of those organisations are in a good position to understand what's happening, perhaps more so than some of the, at a local level I mean, perhaps more so than some of the bodies who are currently listed as being able to report breaches. We do support those organisations being able to report breaches, but widening that, I think, would be really helpful and would feel more empowering for communities, perhaps particularly community councils as a democratically appointed body in a local area.
OK, that's very helpful. Can I thank the witnesses and thank you, convener?
Thanks, Bob. Mark, you wanted to come in with a supplementary.
Yeah, I just wanted to go back on Mr Doris's point about the decision about a 3,000 hectare threshold or a 1,000 hectare threshold or something in between. I mean, is it fair to say there's something of a bit of an arbitrary nature to this selection, and that, 3,000 hectares in one part of Scotland could look very different to 3,000 hectares in another part of Scotland and might bring in quite dramatically different sets of issues in terms of management, local community, opportunities for housing? I mean, we're in a very diverse country, so to sort of put in legislation, land, here's a figure, there needs to be a land management plan, it doesn't feel it kind of, to me, that it reflects the nature of the land. But
well, I'll ask Hamish to comment in detail on that, but it is an issue which we have been considering. I mean, there are differences between the south of Scotland and the northeast of Scotland. The bill does recognise the differences of islands, which I know people get bored of me talking about islands a lot of the time, but there is, there's an island dimension here. There are issues of significance in a landholding. There are some examples presently, I won't go into the detail of them, where, purchase of a significant item within a community is a very, very difficult and damaging thing. So we are very aware of that. And that is a subtlety that may be difficult to express in legislation, but it is there. Hamish.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's no question that it is essentially a matter of judgment that Parliament will make about where that threshold should lie, and clearly it could lie in a number of levels. The point about the variety across Scotland, I think, is absolutely right. I suppose it leads us to the key considerations here, and we recommended, actually, in terms of thresholds overall, that criteria beyond scale would be relevant to look at. Initially, when we put forward our recommendations, for example, on the public interest test and other matters, we were looking at wider criteria, including the sort of community significance, sites of community significance. Having said that, I think we recognise quite straightforwardly that scale is probably the simplest, most transparent and predictable basis on which to set a threshold, and therefore seems very reasonable. I think, as we've touched on before, the ways to address this are either you could bring the threshold down to bring more into scope, and that would be a broad brush approach across Scotland, or you could include more specific criteria that would address the cumulative issue or indeed sites of local significance, which may give you more flexibility or discretion.
Mm-hmm. But your point about land management plans is that regardless of the size of the holding, they need to be transparent, they need to be proportionate as well. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yes. And just one further point is, of course, it throws into relief the importance of continued voluntary good practice for land holdings that are out with the scope of the legislative requirements.
OK, yeah, thanks.
Thanks very much, Mark. Just before we leave this subject, could you just clarify the duration you think a land management plan would last for?
My understanding of what's proposed is that it's a sort of maximum five-year period, and it would need to be reviewed within 5 years. I think it would be reasonable to expect that any significant changes should also prompt a review, but sensible to have a backstop time period.
And do you think 5 years is reasonable? Forestry Land Scotland's land management plans are considerably longer than 5 years. And bearing that in mind, the comment that you've just made, what do you estimate the cost of producing a management plan would be?
In terms of timescales, I mean, I think 5 years is a reasonable timescale in terms of a review period. Clearly, the plan itself should be looking longer term, and you would expect that. I also think, I mean, given that we're at a headline stage in the bill, there is work to be done on looking at the learning from existing processes. We're well aware of land management plans that operate across the forestry sector, across private sector initiatives like Wildlife Estates Scotland, across other land use sectors. I think there's a lot of learning that we can take from how those operate and making sure that it has that long-term perspective in it.
And the cost, Hamish?
We haven't done any parallel costing, so I'm aware of the government costings in the bill memo. We haven't costed ourselves separate proposals.
I mean, I'm just I agree with management plans. I tried to look at the Glenprasen management plan, which was purchased off the market 2 years ago. Still no management plan, still no duration of how long it will take to get a management plan, or any ideas of costings, or whether the communities had a feed into it, were the answers I got from Forestry Land Scotland. That is something you'd be trying to stop, is it?
Yes. Yeah, very clearly there should be transparency, predictability. I know Forestry and Land Scotland, I think, have provided some costings to government to assess the likely cost of land management plans. We're engaged, Emma, with them directly in Glenprasen as an example.
The reality is that the cost of land management plans will vary considerably depending on the context in which the land holding sits, depending on existing prior relationships with communities, where those exist and are established, and where there is a history of that kind of planning process, it will be less expensive for an estate to implement it. Where they're trying that something new, different from the start, it's going to be more expensive that first time. But a five-year review period to me feels very sensible, because if you think about communities and how they are looking at things and addressing things, 5 years is actually quite common in that context. But I agree with Hamish, you know, there should be a long-term plan in that land management plan, just a regular review period.
So drawing up a long-term management plan, 15,000-20,000, not unreasonable?
It will vary significantly across the state.
For 3,000 hectares, not unreasonable, is it? I don't know. Hamish?
Well, we don't have a basis to second-guess those figures at the moment, okay. To be honest.
No. Jackie, you wanted to come in before I went to my next questions.
Yes, and I probably should have asked it at the very beginning, so my apologies, convener. Just maybe, I'm going back to the beginning, I'm very sorry, but can you perhaps give us an indication what the current situation is in Scotland in terms of how much of the country is actually owned or controlled by folk? Just by people. Well,
the figures that we have, let me use Andy Whiteman's figures, because they're actually very accurate figures. We think they dovetail their own. Privately owned 83%, publicly owned 11.7%, community owned 2.8%, NGO owned 2.5%. Now, of course, there's much greater detail available from Andy online.
Okay.
And it you can dig down into it. I'm not his agent in any sense.
But, Mr. Ross.
But, you know, his figures, a great deal of work has gone into those, and those figures appear to be accurate.
Thank you. I will definitely have a look into that.
Thanks very much. Just going to ask some questions on pre-notification and registration in the bill. Do you think they're complex or easy to navigate or difficult to navigate? Be interested in your views on that.
I think the bill in general in places is complex, is very complex in some places, and the bill that also, as you know, convener, that amends previous bills is quite difficult to follow, to be absolutely clear about what it means. We would want to see processes as simple as possible, and particularly in terms of community involvement. I think one of the regrettable things at the moment is that the review of community purchase, which is taking place in parallel, will not come up with legislative proposals, which the Commission has made, suggestions about how that process is simplified. And if we could get that process simplified, then I think it would be likely to be a greater take-up.
Sorry, can I just interrupt that?
Yeah.
My recollection, that's due to report in December, isn't it?
Is it just this December or next December? I don't think we know yet.
I mean, it would seem logical to try and shape the results of this bill from that information, surely?
Well, we would hope so, but I'm not aware that is going to take place, but we would have to find that out.
Well, the timescales for this bill would preclude that, would it not?
It would at the moment, yes.
Is that a failure?
I think we would have liked to have seen action on the community purchase at the same time, yes. And of course, there's also a review of community compulsory purchase, which we've had views on and continue to have views on.
It seems they've got disjointed, Hamish.
Yes.
Sorry.
Just add on prior notification, going back to the question. I think, I agree with Michael, undoubtedly it is a complex part of the bill. I think what I wouldn't want to lose in this is the importance of a form of prior notification, and it is something that we recommended very clearly given what we see in the land market. We see the rural land market operating at a very fast pace with very high prices, and it is probably important to say that it's not just about ensuring that communities have access to acquire land. I think it's just as important in terms of opening up opportunities for other individuals, farmers, businesses, to know when land is perhaps coming to the market and therefore be in a position to negotiate if they're seeking to acquire land for any particular purpose. So I think it is a very important measure to have that prior notification and one that goes well beyond enabling community ownership as well.
This could be simplified too in the bill. The advertisement of land, through local press or whatever, might have benefits both for the local press and for those who are interested in land. And I think simplifying it in some way would be helpful.
And prior notification, and then the lotting that leads to it. Are you comfortable that's an easy thing to do? As a land agent, when I was lotting estates, I found it the most difficult thing to do in my life. But it appears in the bill it's quite easy.
We are about to start looking in some detail. I think we'll start this week to look in some detail at the issue of lotting. But certainly it will not be simple. But we would want to find a way or recommendations to make it as simple as possible.
So if the lotting was carried out to allow a community purchase, which is, I think within the scope of the bill, it could devalue the rest of the holding. So there is provision for compensation in the bill for the government to buy the whole thing, but that would be on an open market value without the lotting, surely. Hamish, you're going to say you're...
Well, I think it's probably important to acknowledge that I think the bill expects that all the transactions would be on an open market basis. I think first thing I would flag about lotting is that it is actually a very direct response to the issue that the bill is trying to address in terms of concentration of ownership. So lotting land in these circumstances would be a very direct way of opening up land, making land available in a different way to that would otherwise come forward. So it is a very logical response to the issues that the bill is seeking to address, I think. I think going forward from there, we certainly need clarity then about how the lotting would be considered. And certainly some of the things that we would like to be thinking about are what are the factors that the Land and Communities Commissioner would need to take into account? What are the criteria, for example, that we would consider or the Commissioner would consider in lotting? And I think really important, therefore, that process develops in a way that is predictable so that all parties can understand the kind of decision-making that would take place. And I've got no doubt that the Commissioner would have to seek professional advice in doing that.
I would find it odd if the Commissioner could make that decision, if there is such a Commissioner, without taking professional advice, because it is an aspect of the market which is limited in the amount of professionals that understand it and can do it to the best possible ability, I would suggest. So just going on to that is that, just explain, if you wouldn't, if somebody wants to sell a bit of a land holding over 1,000 hectares to a small community group but doesn't want to sell the rest of it, would that require lotting?
My understanding is no. My reading of the bill is such that if a landowner from a land holding over 1,000 hectares was to sell a part of that holding, that would trigger the prior notification procedure. Clearly, if it is actually intended to sell to a community body, first stop would be a negotiated sale, as per now. The prior notification clearly would kick in. That's there as a backstop, but there's also nothing to stop a negotiated sale and transfer taking place.
But to an individual to buy a house, to build a house then, which is not a community, would that trigger a lotting?
Again, as I read it at the moment, it wouldn't trigger a lotting. It would trigger the prior notification procedure. I think the two are, as I read it, separate. And I think there is a question about the what happens in the case of very small transfers from within holdings over 1,000 hectares. So I think there is something to look at about the proportionality of how, for example, individual house sites or sales to tenants would take place to bring some clarity on that.
I'm just conscious of one of the issues was to free up rural housing and to allow land for development. This may be a negative. So there may be something in here you think requires a little bit further work if it, if it's, say, for a small-scale development, a couple of houses for local people to live in, but not a community?
I think it would be important that the bill is as clear as possible on those matters.
And is it?
I think there's work still to be done.
There's work to be done. Okay. I'm going to push on the rest, let the rest of my questions go, because some of them have been asked already. And I'm going to go to Mark Ruskell for your question.
Thanks. I'd like to explore just a little bit the difference between the transfer test that's in the bill, which applied to the seller prior to sale, compared to, I think, what you wanted to see in the bill, which was the public interest test, which is then applied as it's being sold and puts conditions then on onto the future ownership. So I wonder if you could just explore that a little bit with me, please.
Yeah, the key difference is that the transfer test as proposed applies to the seller of land prior to bringing the sale forward. The public interest test, as we proposed it in our recommendations, would apply to an incoming landowner to the acquisition of land. So the implication of that, obviously, is that the transfer test could intervene and require lotting prior to sale. What it doesn't do is introduce any influence or conditions over the ongoing ownership and use or governance of the landholding. So I think that's the key practical difference between them. Having said that, we did recommend that lotting would be one of the outcomes of the public interest test. And I go back to what I said earlier, where lotting is actually a very direct way of intervening and delivering a less concentrated pattern of land ownership within that particular landholding. So we welcome lotting proposals. We think that, you know, is an effective way to bring more land forward. But as I say, it is different to the public interest holding and does not therefore affect the ongoing ownership of the landholding.
Okay. Why do you think the government has chosen the transfer test then, and will you ask for advice on this particular matter?
No, I don't know. From what I'm aware, I think it's obviously a decision and a judgment around practical delivery and legal context.
Right.
It isn't an either-or, in our view.
Okay.
You could do both.
You could do both. Mm-hmm. So, but within the context of the bill, mm-hmm. that's just a transfer test. Mm-hmm. Okay, but we could introduce a public interest test mm-hmm. in theory. Right, okay. And I think you've covered this already in relation to land management plans, but do you believe that the transfer test should also apply to aggregate land holdings as well, over 1,000 hectares?
I think the same consideration applies to the question of cumulative holdings and whether they are in scope or not.
Okay. So you think there should be consistency in terms of these different measures within the bill, as transfer tests, land management plans?
Yes.
Yes, okay. And then in terms of the transfer test applying to large land holdings, I think currently in the bill it's holdings over 1,000 hectares that it applies to. Do you see an argument to reduce that? And if so, why?
So as it stands at 1,000 hectares, our data suggests that would catch between sort of 5 to 15 whole landholding transactions per year, just looking at the last sort of 3 years of the land market. If you were to reduce that to 500 hectares, you would probably double that with a further 5 to 15 holdings within scope. I think the more you reduce it, clearly, the more you take it into the territory of smaller holdings and agricultural holdings.
Yeah. Okay. I know Monica wants to come in.
Yep, Monica, you're being very polite to each other, which is great to see. Monica, do you want to come in at this stage?
A very polite committee. Good morning to our panel. Yeah, so Mark's question was about the transfer test and the public interest test. Mr. Russell, I think you said it doesn't need to be either or, it could be both. So I just wonder, is this a part of the bill where you might like to see amendments to build that in? What would you say on that?
Yes, I mean, we support the bill and have supported the bill, you know, from publication, but that doesn't mean, you know, and everybody in this room knows it, that the bill can't be improved as it goes through the system. And there are areas in which we think the bill could be more ambitious. And if it were to be more ambitious, this would be certainly one of the areas where we think that reinstating some measure of public interest test as envisaged, originally envisaged, would be helpful. I mean, there are a number of areas where we would, you know, happily say we think that the bill should be more ambitious. We have areas where we'd like to question, for example, I don't know in the end if it's going to come up, but the role, responsibilities and function of the new commissioner is an area that we have considerable interest in, and we would like to see some changes in that. So there, this is one of the areas, yes. And that is a positive thing, because, you know, our bills, as they change, improve. And it would be useful to continue to improve it, continuous improvement.
Mm-hmm. That's what we like to hear. No bill ever comes to us in a perfect forum. I think I'll probably hand back to Mark, but just one question I wanted to raise as we're on lotting. We've heard from some stakeholders some concerns that the lotting process as proposed has loopholes, you know, perhaps quite a few loopholes that could enable further concentration of land ownership. Is that a concern that you share or recognise?
Well, I'll ask Hamish to comment on that, but okay. I indicated also that we're beginning to look at the lotting proposals. I think one of, you know, the roles that we have is to look in detail at some of the things that aren't fleshed out and to make recommendations. And lotting is one area where I think we would want to make sure that if there were such loopholes, we were drawing attention to them. But we haven't done that work as yet, so I can't really comment in detail.
Yeah, and again, probably as with any bill, there are inevitably potential loopholes, which I know government and others and stakeholders are looking at keenly. I mean, I think the particular one here that I've kind of heard flagged up is clearly the question that the bill suggests that no individual would be able to acquire more than one of the lots. But there's nothing at present that would prevent onward sale in future. So I think this comes back to a question of proportionality and where the bill is looking to intervene. Partly comes back to why we proposed a public interest test on acquisition looking forward. But again, it's whether it's reasonable to then, or whether it's possible and reasonable to actually then control beyond the initial transfer at lotting.
I recognise that there's more work to be done and you've got more research to do, so perhaps we can get an update in writing as we go on with this scrutiny. But I just wonder how these proposals compare to regulatory mechanisms internationally and if there are any parallels to be drawn in terms of oversight, intervention outcomes. I know you mentioned at the start your research has looked at 22 other countries, so in terms of lotting, is there anything you can see at this stage?
Yeah, in broad terms, and with the caveat I mentioned earlier that no country can just be lifted to match Scotland, but it is quite common and reasonable for interventions at the point of sale to make sure that land is structured in a way that actually will help deliver opportunities. So, I think I referred to the French SAFA system, which is all about opening up opportunities, making land available for developing farmers and businesses. There are other mechanisms in Europe that are actually largely at a municipal level that influence the structure of landholdings, but also influence who is able to then acquire them and maybe set conditions on future use, residency use, etc.
And just in terms of who takes decisions, would you say it's correct that lotting decisions should be made by ministers rather than more locally based bodies such as, you know, local councils? And what scope is there for communities to be involved in the lotting process?
So on the first question, I think we've been clear, I think, in our advice generally that where possible, these decisions should be made effectively as locally as possible. And again, if we're comparing with other countries, it's quite common for the kind of decisions we're talking about here to be made at municipal level. Mm-hmm. Now, we don't quite have the equivalent local governance structure in Scotland. So I think we have to look afresh at our conditions and our context here. In terms of the way the measures are proposed, I think it's entirely reasonable that the decision lies with ministers, given the balance of things that they will be taking into account, the balance of public and private interests, the human rights context, and the questions of compensation. So that seems entirely appropriate to be a ministerial decision. On the involvement of communities, I would fully expect that the Land and Communities Commissioner, in the way that they approach advice on lotting, would be seeking views and taking account of local knowledge, expertise and experience.
Thank you. hand back to you, Mark.
And then I'm going to come to the Deputy Convener for his questions.
I think, we've covered most of the questions, I think, that we wanted to ask, but I just wanted to finally ask you about the definition of community sustainability, what your thinking was to not recommend that appears on the face of the bill. Is it just too difficult to provide a robust definition of that? And if you don't provide a definition of that, is there a danger that areas like community housing, for example, become less considered, less defined in this legislation, and missed opportunities might arise as a result?
I think what we would suggest is that it's important to have as broad a definition of the public interest shaping the transfer test as possible. For lotting to be really effective and have the most impact, a broad definition of the public interest would enable that. I think it is fairly common across bills not to try and define that public interest on the face of a bill, recognising that it does change and it's a judgment for Parliament, Government and ministers over time. But certainly in our advice, we did recommend some practical kind of criteria, for example, around the control of local resources, control of local housing supply, control of local economic opportunities, local infrastructure. So I think there are some practical criteria that we could see perhaps at a guidance level that would start to bring some clarity on how you might interpret that public interest.
Okay, so you'd see that coming through guidance, not a big list within a bill.
That was also the situation with the 2016 Act in the end, if you will recall, that the definition did not appear on the face of the bill, but the subsequent documentation and guidance and secondary legislation tied it down more closely.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
I'm going to come to Ben for his questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, all. Going back to the considerations around a public interest test, I represent the most densely populated part of urban Scotland, and this will apply to all of urban Scotland in this housing emergency that we face, that the cost of land is a real prohibitor in many instances for social landlords to build more housing, and the land banking of particular areas of our cities is a real problem. There have been measures that have been taken that have made an impact, but there's still work to do. And I wondered, I know you've produced papers on a public interest-led approach to development. Do you want to say a bit more about how a public interest test could make a difference in an urban context as well as a rural one?
Yes, I'll be quite upfront to start with that the evidence base and the research that we did that led to the recommendation was clearly based in a rural landholding context. But we acknowledged at the time that actually the same issues of concentration of power can, of course, occur in an urban situation. I think in terms of what the measures in the bill at the moment and how they might apply or could apply in an urban context, I think the most kind of likely connection is around the inclusion of sites of community significance or the kind of the flexibility or the discretion that kind of criteria would bring into it. But I think also more widely, we continue to see big opportunities and frankly a big need for land reform in urban Scotland. And I think I would draw attention to recommendations that go beyond the scope of the bill, particularly in terms of compulsory sales orders to bring vacant and derelict sites back into use. And indeed the housing land recommendations that you referred to, the public interest-led development. I suppose the connection is we see a much stronger, more active role for public bodies to be deliberate in making land available for development and bringing it forward in conditions that can allow that to happen.
And were you also disappointed that land value capture was not considered as part of this process?
Again, we have offered some advice on land value capture. Recognise that, again, is another complex topic that probably requires its own legislation. We're engaged at the moment with the review of the compulsory purchase order, where, again, we see significant opportunity to simplify, to modernise, to make sure that that's practical and that local authorities have both the capacity and the confidence to be able to use those. And I suppose it brings us back to even looking beyond the scope of the bill, there are a range of other measures that need to be used and taken forward in parallel with these to deliver on the land reform ambitions.
But within the scope of the bill, a public interest test could make a meaningful difference in urban Scotland.
I think that's the one aspect that could connect most strongly to urban Scotland here.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ben. I'm going to go to Douglas Lumsden for the next question, and then that sort of brings us to the end of part one. I think I've got a question before we finish it, and then I'm going to take a short pause before we go on to the intricacies of part two. So, Douglas.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. And we've heard earlier about the new Land and Communities Commissioner. And the financial memorandum on the bill, I've got it here, actually. It's so the Commission will require ongoing resource funding to cover the costs for the new Commissioner and additional staffing costs. But it's proposed that these costs will only be partially met through new funding and partially met through existing funding to the Commission by reducing their current activities, such as their policy work. So in practice, and it's probably a question for Mr Trench, what's that going to mean for the Commission, for all the other work that you were doing, and is that going to have an impact?
Yeah, so I should be very clear that there, to deliver the new functions that are proposed for the Land and Communities Commissioner, that cannot be done within our existing resource commitment. Without significantly changing what we currently deliver. So the choices are essentially that we would either reduce the policy advice, the advice that we give on policy, legislation and practice, and or that we would reduce the good practice advice. We have seen over the years actually a growing demand for the advice that we provide into practice to supporting people to make change happen on the ground. And we would expect that to continue to grow. So I think those would be the choices facing the Commission if we didn't have an additional resource burden commensurate with the functions coming in.
So I guess you would be making an appeal to government to actually fully fund this new sort of remit that you're going to have?
Well, we can be straightforward about the funding that would be needed to deliver those. It is, of course, perfectly reasonable to question, for both us, government and others, to question what the balance of that spend should be. But I certainly see a continued value in the policy advice and the good practice advice that we are providing at the moment.
But I guess as it stands, then that will have to reduce to fund some of these new functions. Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. Just before we leave that appointment, were you all in total favour of needing a separate person to do this? Mike, were you in favour?
No. Let me put it this way. It's a perfectly acceptable proposal. We would like to discuss that proposal in the light of other possibilities. There are two things that observations we'd make. The first of which is that it is possible to envisage a situation in which the powers are vested in the entire Commission and not in a single Commissioner. Mr Lumsden's point about the costs of that would change the cost balance substantially. It is a model that exists in other bodies, SEPA, for example, and Nature Scott, where the regulatory function is held by the Commissioners. Clearly, the present proposal is modelled upon the experience of the Tenant Farming Commissioner. The second one is, if however the model is to be the one that is proposed in the bill, we want to make sure that the collegiate nature of operation of the Commission is sustained, and therefore we want to make sure that there is a closer relationship between the Land and the new Commissioner and the existing Commissioner, and we want to make sure that there is an obligation on the new Commissioner to work with and consult with his or her colleagues. So those are issues that we think are live issues in terms of how this eventually pans out.
So I'm not quite clear. Is that meaning scrapping one of the Land Commissioners and bringing this person in?
No, that's not the proposal that exists at the moment.
Never gets smaller.
But you could envisage not increasing the number of commissioners and ensuring that the function was held corporately by the Commission, though it would increase the staffing costs. I mean, you made the point, Convener, about land agents. There will be significant increased costs in here, for example, in professional advice, and there will also be significant increased costs in the support that will be required. I mean, the Tenant Farming Commissioner has dedicated support within the Commission. That would require at least and probably more in terms of this new role.
Okay. Just before we finish this, and I think Jackie may want to come in the back of something I'm going to ask, is that when the Bute House agreement was in place, Lorna Slater announced that there would be £2 billion of investment needed from private investors to help us reach our net zero and tree planting targets. Do you think part one of this bill will effectively stop those investors wanting to come to Scotland? Do you think it's going to frighten them? You think they'll just continue to invest as the government said they were needed?
Well, I think the bill is not a bill that should frighten anyone. The bill is redolent with opportunity. The question is, can the bill be improved to be even more advantageous for the entire nation, in actual fact, for people, for power and prosperity? Hamish, you know, has worked closely on this prior to me becoming chair, and would might want to comment on it.
Well, just on that specific context, no, I don't think it will have that effect. And partly because we've seen over the last couple of years a shift where actually corporates and financial institutions are less interested in actually buying land directly in Scotland for those purposes. And of course, to invest, they don't need to acquire and own land. They are also seeking to invest and deliver that through existing land managers, through partnerships with communities, through others. So I don't think there's an automatic impact there.
But Gresham House, for example, we heard, were actually quite big landowners in Scotland. And they would say they're delivering benefit for Scotland reaching our net zero targets. So do you think they will be unperturbed by the lotting and the notification and all the things within Part 1 of the bill?
If they were perturbed, then I hope all of us would be seeking to give them some comfort in the fact that we think this bill, as I say, is redolent of opportunity for their sector and for the entire sector.
OK, it looks like I've opened up a whole lot of questions here, but I did promise Jackie next, and then I'll come to Mark.
My question's probably a bit blunter than what yours is, Convener. I was just wanting to know if you've got a view on the belief that those with the broadest shoulders, for example, those who are privileged enough to own multi-million pound estates and landholders, should bear the greatest burden in reaching our goals of net zero and nature restoration.
Well, clearly the obligation goes with the property in terms of, for example, biodiversity and other issues. So there has to be a recognition of that, and from each according to his ability, so to speak, his or her ability. I don't know if Hamish wants to add to that, but I think that we would accept that that is an obligation that people have and are willing to enter into.
Mark, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, obviously there are huge opportunities, with or without this bill, for investment in nature and carbon markets. But I wondered if you saw this bill as an opportunity to regulate those markets, because at the moment, they're largely unregulated, and it can feel to some communities like a bit of a Wild West.
We have our toe in that water, and Hamish might want to explain what we're doing and what our thinking is.
Yes.
A variety of reasons, Hamish. I'm going to ask you to do this briefly because I need to bring in Bob, and I have a wee break that's required coming up shortly, Hamish.
Briefly, whether it's this bill or another means, then yes, we do think there's a need for stronger regulation of the carbon and nature markets, particularly of the buyer end of that. There are existing codes, for example, on the supplier side. We also think the other key issue here is the distribution of benefit. We have guidance in place. We publish guidance on the way that communities benefit. Again, some of that needs to be embedded much more strongly through policy, through requirements and conditionality.
But in legislation at this point, is it too early to codify some of that work in legislation? Does it need to go into legislation?
I think it seems clear that regulation has to play a part of that, and we're working, we're providing advice into the nature markets framework that the Scottish Government are developing at the moment. I hope that will clarify the balance of incentive and regulation that's required.
Okay.
And I'm going to bring in Bob, who's got a question on resourcing. Bob.
Yeah, Convener, it was inspired by your question about potential financial burdens on the land commissioners and compromising other areas of what they may or may not do. Hamish might be best placed, but I'm just wondering, right now, in relation to the broadest shoulders paying, what do the largest landowners or large land management companies, Gresham House, for example, own no land in Scotland in 2012, they currently have 53,000 hectares, so we see the direction of travel there in relation to their work. Is there any levy on those largest landowners or land management companies currently in relation to regulatory functions? And is there the opportunity to do some of this in a very proportionate and responsible way, of course?
Hamish.
Short answer is no. There isn't any provision like that directly in relation to these kind of measures at the moment.
And his consideration, I'm new to this, Hamish. You're not. I'm trying to scrutinise this bill. Is there examples where that happens elsewhere in the world? And has the Land Commission thought about what a model could look like in Scotland?
Yes, and again, in international context, you find both levies, but also the tax. I mean, I think this takes us to our advice on the tax and fiscal policy. We have, for example, proposed that there could be a surcharge on land buildings transaction tax for high-value land transactions, again, recognising the significant public value or the value that is created by public policy, particularly in relation to nature and climate context. So there are mechanisms, but I think we would look to and advise looking to the tax system really to deliver that kind of transfer back into public value.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bob. Obviously thought for the financial memorandum there. On that note, I'm just going to pause. It is 10:28, I think it is. We'll be back here, please, 10:35 or thereby. So I suspend the meeting. Thanks very much. And we now reconvene the meeting on the Land Reform Bill. And I get the next question, so it was probably appropriate that I had a break to get myself ready for it, but I was ready for it anyway, and to ask the Land Commission, who hosts the Tenant Farming Advisory Forum, how much has the development of Part 2 of the Act been based on agreement within that forum? Probably Bob's the expert here.
We had quite a lot of engagement with Scottish Government officials on Part 2 up to a certain point. And that engagement was very helpful, and officials are very open with us. We would have liked that engagement to go a bit further so that we would see more of the details, because, as always, the devil is in the detail. I think, frankly, had we seen more of the detail, we could have avoided perhaps some of the issues which have come up.
Okay, I'm not sure that specifically answered the question. So I was sort of trying to delve in the Tenant Farming Association, Land Estate, National Farmers Union, Agricultural Arbiters and Valuers Association, Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, Agricultural Law Association, as well as the Scottish Government. Did they all have a big input into Part 2?
They were all at the meetings when Part 2 was discussed with Scottish Government officials. As I said, officials were very good at bringing stuff to us and discussing it with us. But I would have liked that engagement to go a bit further into the details of what came out in the bill, because I think we could have added some extra value at that stage, as well as at the principal stage.
OK, Bob, indulge me. Which area, for example, do you feel that you didn't have enough engagement?
Well, I think on all of them, when it got down to the detail, you know, there are things that have been thrown up that perhaps we hadn't discussed when we were talking about the broader principles. And I could say that on quite a few of the issues in the bill.
OK, that slightly concerns me. I struggled with my background in agricultural tenancy law to understand all of it. So maybe we can, when we delve into it, we'll find out a bit more. Monica, I think you've got the next question.
I wanted to ask about the model lease for environmental purposes, just to get your views on that. And what needs do you see this responding to? And is it the most effective way of doing so?
Well, I think the background is that there's recognition that letting land for more than agriculture is going to be a bigger thing in future, with all the natural capital, forestry, etc. So could that be done under existing agricultural leases? No, there's a limit how far you can stretch the definition of agriculture, I think. So I think the background was, the feeling was, that a new form of tenancy which had a broader approach, including land being let for all sorts of different purposes, might be helpful. And I think it might be helpful, but I think there's some lack of clarity at the moment as to whether this is a new form of lease which would operate within the current agricultural holdings legislation, or whether it is indeed a new form of tenancy which would be outside of the current legislation and would leave more for landlords and tenants to agree on. I think the latter is what we'd expected. I think the latter is probably what most stakeholders are looking for. And maybe government just needs to clarify if that is indeed what's intended. I think it's what's intended, but it's not clear from the bill.
OK, so certainly looking for more clarity on that. And in terms of the model lease, again, I know I've asked already today about practice from elsewhere, but are there examples of this from other places, other countries, and any other lessons that you think we could learn?
Not aware of any other similar things.
OK. I don't know if colleagues have anything to add. No. Do you have a view on the relationship between the model lease proposals and existing legislation relating to agricultural holdings? We've heard from some respondents that the policy memorandum states that the template should only be used where less than half of land management is agricultural, but it's not explicit in the provisions of the bill. Again, is that an area where you think we need more clarity?
Yes, my own view is that it should be outside of the scope of the current agricultural holdings legislation, and I don't think specifying a certain percentage of agriculture is particularly helpful. I think it could be, should be available for any sort of letting of land that people choose to do if they don't want to use the current agricultural holdings leases to do it.
Okay, thank you. Does this proposal, as well as other aspects of the bill, make adequate provision for the role that land might play in delivering a just transition to net zero and also in tackling the biodiversity crisis?
I think it does. I think the important thing has been to ensure that in the new sort of paradigm of regenerative agriculture and sustainable agriculture, that tenants are able to play a part alongside owner-occupiers. And there have been, without some of the changes in the bill, it might have been difficult for tenants to play a full part. I think the bill has done a pretty good job in making sure that tenants, you know, won't be excluded. Things like extending the rules of good husbandry and the definition of agriculture, I think, were needed in order to allow tenants to engage in things that at the moment wouldn't be strictly considered as agriculture and therefore might technically be in breach of their lease if they were to do them, even though government's encouraging them to do them. So there was a bit of housekeeping needing done there, and I think government has done that.
That's helpful, thank you. On the model lease for environmental purposes, anything else you would want to add?
No, I think it's just getting that clarity about exactly how it's going to work would be helpful to the sector.
Okay.
Just before we leave that, Bob, could you explain to me who's? I understand the need that, you know, why some people might like to do this. I'm trying to understand who those people are. Are they the big organisations that, you know, are they the big charities, the environmental charities, or are they existing farmers? And if they're existing farmers, you're going to take something out of what may be a secure lease into an insecure lease on a short-term basis.
Yes, you'd only be able to change the form of lease by agreement. I mean, that's the key thing. No one could insist on our tenant moving to the new form of tenancy. I think it's something that might be useful, that might be of interest to a whole range of landowners. I don't expect it to be a big issue, frankly, in future.
How many a year?
Couldn't even guess. A few, I think, rather
under
than
10.
Many. Possibly.
Okay, thank you. Next question is from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, Bob, can I ask you about where you see smallholders sitting? Should they be brought under the legislative framework for crofting, or do you think the existing provision for agricultural tenants meets the needs of smallholders in particular?
Yeah, it's an interesting one. When this first came up, my sort of first reaction was they look more like a crofter than a tenant to me, and therefore maybe better going into the crofting legislation. Government has decided to bring them into the mainstream agricultural holdings swim. I think that's equally valid, and I think giving them the sort of rights and responsibilities that agricultural tenants have is probably a good thing to do. They've been sitting there operating under some very ancient legislation, which has caused a few problems, and I think the government proposal will bring a lot more clarity to both smallholders and their landlords about who can do what and how they react together. Okay. So I think that's a positive thing.
Okay, but I think the Scottish Crofting Federation and the Land Workers Alliance take a different view. They would rather see smallholders sitting within the crofting legislation. I'm just wondering why you take a different view to that.
I think it could have gone either way.
Okay.
And I think either would have worked. Government has chosen to go down this route, and I think that'll work too.
What would be the advantages and disadvantages of going one way or another? Do you think there is no difference? Or?
Well, fortunately, I'm not very au fait with crofting legislation, so I know there are lots of implications of being a crofter, which are even more complicated sometimes than being a tenant. So there may be something in the crofting legislation which would make it more difficult to work or more unattractive to landlords. I'm really not sure.
Okay.
But I think what government's proposed will be very helpful to smallholders and will work pretty well.
Okay. So would you distinguish it in terms of, with crofting We've also got common grazing as collective land, which is managed. Small holdings, individual holdings. Is that the big
That's one of the big differences.
Why you think they fall more into being the tenancy side than the crofting side?
Yes, I think they've probably got more affinity with a normal agricultural tenant in some ways because of that.
Okay. I mean, I'm sure we'll get more evidence coming in on this, convener, but yeah, I'll leave it there just now.
Thanks very much. I've got just some questions on... there's a lot of things in part two which I can understand. I'm just trying to understand resumption. Causes me a little bit of concern, this, and the different ways of dealing with resumption. Of course, if you've got a 91 Act tenancy, resumption's only valid if it's in the lease, I think, is a thing. And there is a way of valuing that resumption. And if you're in a subsequent lease, there's a different way of doing it, and it's valued in a different way. Do you want to explain how this bill helps in that? Because it certainly confused me.
Right, I'll try not to make this too technical if I can.
I love technical things.
Yeah. I mean, under certain conditions, a landlord can resume land out of a tenancy, not everywhere. If the landlord does that, the tenant is entitled to compensation for the loss of that land. I think there's general feeling that the compensation that's payable needs to be reviewed. What government is proposing is to bring in a method of valuing the compensation which was designed for another purpose and which would very significantly increase the compensation. Tenants would say that's justified, landlords would say it increases it too much, and therefore it's going to put landlords off offering new tenancies. And that is the issue, I think, with all of this legislation. We have to look at it through two lenses. Does it help existing tenants? But what does it do to landlords' willingness to let land? And there's a balance there to be struck. And I think with the proposed resumption compensation, there's perhaps it's swinging slightly too far towards disincentivising landlords. I think compensation for resumption needs to be increased, but there's probably a different way of doing it which isn't quite so extreme that would bring landlords on board a bit more.
So my understanding is under a 91 Act you can only resume land providing it's in the lease,
yeah,
and it's not a fraud on the lease, i.e. it doesn't make it impossible to continue farming as it
yeah,
stands in the original lease. And then there's a set formula for that, isn't there, which is, Bob?
Yes, which essentially it's a multiple of the year's rent and stuff.
So is it five times the multiplication?
Essentially, you could end up with five times the annual rent.
And the, so the 2003 yeah, Act brought in a different form of tenancy, and that's valued in a different way, isn't it?
Yes, it's not quite as generous probably in the 2003 Act tenancy, but this would make it hugely more generous. And that is the issue, I think, is it making it so generous that future landlords will say this is a real turn-off for me providing a tenancy? We've got to look at this against the background that the area of tenanted land in Scotland is declining, and it'll only stop declining if landlords have sufficient incentive to lease land to make land available for tenancies. So we have to be careful not to disincentivise landlords from doing so. And as I say, I think the compensation needs to be increased. I think government may have gone a bit too far in what they're proposing in terms of the way compensation is calculated. They're using a methodology which is designed for a different circumstance, and maybe we need a more bespoke way of doing it.
Okay, so just pushing you slightly on something you've said there, is this is retrospectively changing legislation, and every time the government does that, it puts landlords off. Is that what you're saying?
Well, there's a risk of that. Much of what is in the bill which advantages tenants, I think, is very justified. But there are a few things like this where we just need to be careful to get the balance right.
OK, I'm just looking at since land reform started, the number of agricultural tenancies has declined, which I don't think is personally, as an agricultural tenant, not a great thing. I would like to see more land available for people to farm. But every time you put them off, it's every time the legislation's changed. Is that not a fair assessment?
Sometimes the way the legislation changes has had that effect, I think, yes.
A qualified yes, then. And a qualified thing that the resumption is perhaps difficult. I think, Douglas, have I missed anyone out? I'm looking around the committee. I think, Douglas, you've got some questions before it comes back to me.
No, I had questions later, convener.
Sorry?
My questions were later, convener, on staff.
I think, yes. I mean, there are some questions about improvements and sustainable regenerative agriculture and how you value that at WAGO, Bob. That's an easy thing. I found WAGO, when I was a surveyor, perhaps the most difficult thing that I ever did. So actually having a formulaic process is quite good. So is it easy with sustainable and regenerative agriculture to have a formulaic WAGO valuation?
Well, I don't think it's formulaic. I think what the standard clay procedure is trying to do at the moment is just to make sure that WAGO claims are settled before the end of the tenancy. There's too many occasions just now where the tenant maybe left his tenancy 6 months ago and they're still arguing with the landlord about what sort of WAGO settlement he's going to have. And often that's because people don't start the process early enough. So the proposal under the WAGO bits of the bill is that the whole process should start earlier and be a stricter timetable, which tries to ensure that the settlements are done as the tenant leaves the holding and not way beyond that period. And at the moment, that's the only application for the proposed standard claims procedure.
Okay. I think there is, I mean, I can see the merit in getting it sorted quickly and stopping the arguments on RMVs and UMVs and all the other things that go as part of the WAGO compensation and the use of fodder and whether it's to be put back on the holding and all those sort of issues. Technical issues, which I'm sure won't interest other people, but I do find them interesting. Douglas, it is definitely you.
Yes.
Now.
Thank you, convener, and it's still on the standard claims procedure. And it's in your submission, you raised a number of issues in relation to different sections of the bill regarding how a valuer is appointed. So the process for appointing a valuer differs in different sections of the bill. So how do you think a valuer should be appointed? And does this differ depending on the type of valuation? I'm not quite sure who would that go, probably Bob.
In general, I would say it should be left to landlord and tenant to agree on a valuer. If they can't agree, then by all means, tenant farming commissioner should appoint an independent valuer. There are lots of independent valuers out there. There's really no reason why a landlord and tenant shouldn't be able to agree on one unless they're being bloody-minded. So I would say, for all of these issues, landlord and tenant agree on a valuer. If they can't agree on one, then tenant farming commissioner appoints one.
So do you think the bill's almost too prescriptive just
I think,
now?
In that sense, I think it is a bit too prescriptive, yes.
Mm-hmm. Because normally they can work it out themselves, they can get a valuer themselves.
Yes.
And it's only when that's an issue, then it maybe.
That would be my recommendation, yeah.
Right, OK, that's interesting. Thanks.
And back to the deputy convener now, Ben.
Thank you, convener.
Sorry, hold on 2 seconds.
Yeah.
Did you want a supplementary on? Oh, sorry, I missed that, Jackie.
Yes.
I apologise.
It was in regards to the valuer. You were saying about approving one. Does that go for if there was rent increases as well, that a valuer would be appointed, or is that totally?
It doesn't apply to rent increases. No, that's a negotiation between landlord and tenant. And if they fail to agree, then at the moment the legislation says it has to be referred to the Land Court for a determination.
Okay, which is very expensive.
It can be.
So, sorry, I'm going off slightly off topic, so excuse me, Mr. McPherson. So, is there any way that is there anything that can be done so that so that the tenant doesn't need to go down the road of a land court hearing because it's so expensive. Is there anything that you could suggest to maybe, before it gets to that stage, an arbiter or something?
Well, I'd rather hope that the bill might have included provision to look at this through secondary legislation, because I do think there is a need to have a cheaper and simpler way of resolving rent disputes that doesn't necessarily involve the land court. There, arbitration, different forms of arbitration are available. The problem at the moment is if you don't like the results of the arbitration, you can appeal it to the land court, which kind of defeats the object, because the arbitration then just becomes an intermediate step on the way to the land court. So I think a binding arbitration, which is not appealable to the land court, might well be a better way of resolving rent disputes.
OK, thank you. And my apologies to the Deputy Convener, because I kind of overtook that bit.
OK, and I know the Deputy Convener's got some questions in this area, and I have a few as well, so Deputy Convener.
Thank you. In the same considerations around rent reviews, in your both your submission and in wider work, you have noted several detailed issues in relation to the provisions on rent reviews. And I was just wondering if you could expand on these.
Yes, I think landlord and tenant can use any method they like to agree rent, but if they fall out, it goes to the land court. And the things the land court take into account at the moment are very largely rents of comparable holdings as evidence. And that's okay, but it's been very difficult because under the GDPR regulations, it's not always possible to know which holding is being presented as a comparable rent, and therefore the other party has a problem verifying whether the comparable rent is indeed comparable. So I think the addition of productive capacity, which is proposed by government as an element in working out what rent should be payable, is much to be welcomed. It provides another factor that you can use as evidence in a rent negotiation. And it's based on, you know, how much the holding can earn, must have a relationship to how much rent it can pay. So the productive capacity is essentially an assessment of how much the holding can earn, and that can be used as an additional factor in the rent negotiation. So I think having the two factors and being able to use them as a sense check against each other is much better than having really one major factor to use in a rent negotiation. So I welcome the addition of that.
Okay. And in relation to part two of the bill as introduced, you also indicated that you were supportive of efforts to give confidence and certainty to the tenanted sector, but drew attention to the continued decline in tenanted land, which you've also mentioned just a few moments ago, and the risks of disincentivising letting land in future. Do you want to say a bit more about whether the bill strikes the right balance between supporting tenants and incentivising letting land, and are there any additional changes that are needed to ensure the right balance is struck over and above what you said a few moments ago?
I think by and large it does. My main concern, as I said before, would be around the resumption situation. I think that's one where that balance perhaps needs to be reconsidered. The rest of the proposals in the bill, I think, are generally, I would support.
Okay, thank you. Convener?
Thank you very much. Can I just go back to rent? It's always been a difficult one, and I think from my days was a question of sitting around a table with a cup of tea and working out what was the best and acceptable to both parties. I think that's the way it worked, but there are certain formulaic things in here, and I understand that. Where I don't understand it is you're making some changes, but farming has changed a lot since 91 and previous to that, you know, where house letting may be vitally important. It certainly is to my farming enterprise to be able to offset the cost by letting redundant cottages on the farm, but no account's taken of that in rent. Do you think that's fair and right?
Well, I think it will be taken into account in the rent thing. I mean, if the tenant is using some of the fixed equipment that's been rented to him for non-agricultural purposes, which would be things like letting for bed and breakfast or something, that would be taken into account in the rent calculation, rent negotiation.
And then, of course, the question is on fixed equipment, who's responsible for maintaining it? Is that the tenant or the landlord?
Ah, yes. Well, that is an area which causes an awful lot of problems between landlords and tenants. The law is clear in principle, but there are lots of grey areas there, I'm afraid.
Fixed equipment doesn't include houses, does it? Or does it?
Yes.
It does include houses. So if the housing bill that was to come in, which put fairer stipulations on what the letting conditions of the housings would require, that would fall to the landlord, and the landlord would then expect to see an increase in rent if it's being used for non-agricultural purposes? Is that what you're saying?
That's one of the big discussion points at the moment, is how any changes to housing legislation will affect the agricultural holding sector. In the past, the government has got round that by exempting the agricultural holding sector. That's not going to be tenable in the future. So the discussion needs to be had about how those responsibilities are divided up between landlord and tenant in future in housing situations. Because you've got a farmhouse occupied by the farmer, there might be a tied house occupied by a worker, there might be a house that's let to the farmer's parents who've retired or to a third party altogether. In each of these situations, there's a debate about who is the deemed landlord and who is responsible for new insulation and such like things like that. That is an area of active discussion just now, and which we would hope to resolve through the future housing bill.
And not resolved as part of this, so we would have no idea about how the rent was appropriate.
I don't think we can resolve that housing thing at the moment through this bill, I think.
Okay, my other question was on game damage, and I'm a little bit confused about that. I'm not sure. It's a damage to fixed equipment. Sorry, could you just explain that? I've got some idea about a deer charging down and knocking down a farm building, but that's obviously not what you meant, is it?
No, I think the sort of definition of damage by game is being extended beyond just crops to things like fixed equipment. A very common thing is you get a herd of red deer coming into your silage fields overnight and they knock the fences down or the walls down in the process. So that's not damage to crops, but it's damage caused by game. So these things will now be caught within the legislation where they weren't before.
So just so I understand this, you know, if you had a field and it's your March field and the deer come marauding out of Forestry and Land Scotland's woods, if they were, into your field, not the fence down, which would be a joint liability to repair 50-50 either way, that the landlord would be responsible for that, or Forestry and Land Scotland would be responsible for that, or where's the... I mean, there's confusion here in my mind.
The legislation deals with game damage that's an issue between the landlord and the tenant, so the assumption is that it's the landlord's game who are causing the damage, but you're quite right, and often it's not. It may be coming from a third party's land, the deer or whatever else is causing the nuisance, and that makes it a little bit more difficult to deal with. So then who is responsible? But I think my experience with deer, it has been much more easy to resolve it by using Nature Scot deer officers and the powers that Nature Scot have, rather than trying to resolve it through the agricultural holdings legislation. Nature Scot deer officers have been very helpful in trying to resolve some of these issues.
I understand that, but my concern is it makes it this bill, as I understand it, makes direct contact between the landlord and the tenant, although it may be a third party that's responsible for the damage. Do you think that should be tightened up?
Yes, if the landlord leases the sporting to a third party and it's his game who are causing the problem, then the landlord would be able to seek redress from that person.
It might not even be leasing to a third party. It might be that the wild animals are transferring from another landholder's holding. And that's the issue that I'm trying to understand, because it seems to put the obligation on the landlord where the landlord has no ability to control it.
Well, it's further complicated because if the deer are coming onto the tenant's land and that land is arable or improved pasture, then the tenant has the right under the Deer Act to take action himself to deal with the deer.
So there would be no claim?
So there would be no claim at the moment under that circumstance, because the tenant has the right to take action himself to deal with the deer.
Okay. I think there's scope in there for somewhere. I mean, it's been quite a long session looking at all sorts of aspects of it. I think I'm loath to say, well, how do you all think you can change the bill and make it better? Because I'm sure you'll all have a long thing of views that you could express. But is there anything that we've not touched on that you think we ought to be looking at? Bob, you put your hand up first.
Yes. Back to this resumption thing. The early discussions on this go back quite a few years, and they began with a discussion about compensation payable where a tenant is under an incontestable notice to quit. In other words, the landlord has got planning consent for houses over the whole holding. In those circumstances, he can issue an incontestable notice to quit. The tenant can't challenge that. And the compensation payable in that situation, relative to the uplift in value that the landlord has got, is minimal. And that's where we started the discussions about compensation. Somewhere along the line, the way, it's moved into talking about resumptions generally. But as things stand, a tenant under an incontestable notice to quit is not affected by this legislation, so their compensation is not increased. So if this goes through, we could have a strange situation where a tenant who loses a small part of his land might get more compensation than a tenant who loses the whole of his holding and his business and his livelihood. So I do think if we're going to play around with the compensation for resumption, we also have to look at compensation for tenants under an incontestable notice to quit.
Which means changing old legislation?
Changing the legislation on incontestable notice to quit as well as on resumptions.
Okay. Bob, I think you put your hand up, and I want to give the panel the last chance to have the final word, which may be dangerous. But Bob, do you want to come in briefly, because they may be able to answer it in their wrap-ups?
Convener, I suppose it was just a very general question that might be more about part one than part two of the bill, but I think Mr. Russell was referring us to the kind of Who Owns Scotland, Andy Whiteman update in 2024 in relation to patterns of land ownership in the country following Jackie Dunbar's line of questioning. So more generally, I suppose, what does a successful bill look like in 10 years' time in relation to the pattern of land ownership in Scotland? Should we still expect to see the same 20 huge companies having the same highly dense levels of ownership in the country? Should we see much smaller concerns? What does success look like in relation to that? And I suppose, how do we monitor the impact on tenants and those with small holdings going forward? Because we can use data to show anything. It's about the impact on the ground and whether this improves the quality of experience for individual leaseholders and for communities. So what does success look like?
So without a whole book on that, does anyone want to come in on that? And might probably go in the order. Emma, if you want to say anything, Hamish, and then Mike, if that's all right. Emma, is there any?
I'll pass over on that question.
Hamish, then.
Yeah, I think in the long term, success looks like a much more diverse and dynamic pattern of land ownership that opens up opportunities for individuals, for businesses, for communities to own and use land in all sorts of different ways. And we need that. And we need that mix across the sectors of private, public, NGO, community. I mean, given the challenges we face, we should be using the skills and energy of all those sectors in our land ownership to do this. And absolutely, we think the measures in the bill will help deliver that. And I would also draw attention to the need for wider reforms alongside that, and can go back to some of the work we've done around the wider pattern of tax and fiscal and other reforms, for example.
OK. And without repeating that, Mike, is there anything in the bill that you think we should have addressed this morning?
I think there are a number of things that the bill can be improved on, and we've made those clear, and I think we've covered almost all of them. Public interest tests, the compulsory LMPs and how they might work, the inclusion of wider urban inclusion within the bill, penalties, moderation of prior notification for sale, and the framing of the Land Commissioner's role are all key issues which we think progress can be made on. But, you know, in terms of Bob Doris's question, I think the answer is really very clear. The classic old definition of the Highland problem was, you know, the question of how the resources of the Highlands and Islands were used for the widest benefit of the people of the Highlands and Islands. That's a Scotland-wide question. How are the land resources in Scotland used for the benefit of the people of Scotland? And that's a central task, I think, that the Land Commission addresses itself to provide evidence and to provide information and to open those debates up in a way that we can get a resolution that is, as much as possible, a consensual resolution, and that's what we'll endeavour to do. But I think the pattern of legislating just every 10 years on land reform probably is a pattern that has almost had its day. I think what we need to do is also to get to the stage where people feel comfortable with the dispensation that exists and in those circumstances can invest in the countryside, make sure that they are accessing the land around them, and feel that Scotland has changed in a way that was anticipated at the start of devolution and hasn't yet been completed.
Thank you very much for that, and thank you for attending this morning and sharing your views. That does conclude our part of the public meeting, but just to say that we will be continuing on this theme for the next, quite a long time, I think up till Christmas at least, in the evidence sessions we're taking. And just to also say, the committee will be stepping outside the committee room to engage with people. And the first event is at the Royal Highland Show, where there's a panel which includes Andy Whiteman, so there is a chance to engage with him on this subject as well as the other panellists. So thank you very much, and we'll now move into private session.